The learning objectives of this chapter are to understand how the arrangements put in hand prior to entry into an enclosed or confined space continue and develop when the space is occupied, and to examine some of the emergency procedures that may have to be put into effect. Entry into the enclosed or confined space has been permitted because the responsible officer has verified that the preparations, as established in the plan, are all in place. Note that, unless all necessary safety precautions can be followed, an enclosed or confined space should only be entered by personnel wearing breathing apparatus, appropriate personal protection against exposure to flammable, toxic, or corrosive cargo vapours, and, if practicable, a lifeline. The operation has now entered the next phase, and many of the precautions will continue to be required. The continuing safe occupation of the enclosed or confined space depends on those who have entered the space and the watchman remaining alert and watching for any changes in circumstances that may render the space unsafe. Positive fresh air ventilation should continue during the period that the space is occupied and during temporary breaks. In the event of a failure of the ventilation system, any personnel in the space should leave immediately. The atmosphere should be tested periodically whilst the space is occupied, both for oxygen content and the presence of flammable vapours. Personnel should be instructed to leave the space if any deterioration of the conditions is noted. The atmosphere should be checked periodically from a remote location, normally the deck, and the readings recorded. The team inside should also have their personal monitors, programmed to read the atmosphere continuously. Preset alarm levels should trigger both an audible and a visual alarm on the unit in the event of deterioration of the atmosphere in the vicinity, or in the event of a failure of the monitor. Some units also have a vibration capability. If unforeseen difficulties or hazards develop, the work in the space should be stopped and the space evacuated so that the safety of the situation can be reassessed. Permits should be withdrawn and only reissued with any appropriate revisions after the situation has been reassessed and any additional controls deemed necessary have been put in place. If the period of validity of the enclosed space entry permit or other relevant permit to work has expired and not been replaced or renewed, then work should cease and the space should be evacuated. This is a situation that should not occur with a well-planned operation and close monitoring of the situation, but it must be appreciated that such permits do expire and, if exceptional circumstances have led to the permit reaching the limits of its validity, then exiting the space is the only option possible. If any personnel in a space begin to feel sick or dizzy, or are in any other way adversely affected, they should give the prearranged signal to the watchman standing by the entrance and immediately leave the space. If the watchman is concerned by the signals or actions of the team inside, he should immediately raise the alarm. If someone inside the space is feeling unwell, he may have difficulty in exiting the space and be in need of assistance. Should an emergency occur, the general alarm should be sounded so that the rescue team immediately assembles and backup is available. The watchman should remain by the access to the space and clearly and calmly appraise the emergency team leader of the situation when he arrives on site. Depending on the assigned safety duties on the vessel, the watchman may be in the part of the rescue team to enter and undertake the rescue, but he should not, under any circumstances, enter the space alone, or before the rest of the rescue team has arrived. The rescue team must be well prepared and trained regularly, because time is critical in recovering casualties who have been overcome in enclosed or confined spaces. They should be thoroughly familiar with the rescue equipment and effective in working and communicating as a team. If air is being supplied through an airline to the person who is feeling unwell, a check should immediately be made that the air supplied is being maintained at the correct pressure and is free from sources of contamination. The cause may be related to heat exhaustion, but if the problem originates with the air supply, others being supplied from the same source may also become affected. Once the casualty is reached, the checking of the air supply must be the first priority. Unless he is gravely injured, such as having sustained a broken back, he should be removed from the dangerous space as quickly as possible. If movement is not immediately possible, then resuscitation and medical equipment will need to be taken inside the space. The medical team may have to wear breathing apparatus themselves to treat the casualty. This ship was a 9,695 deadweight tons chemical tanker. At the time of the incident, she was engaged in tank cleaning following discharge of a cargo of ethylene dichloride. The center tanks were stainless steel, and the wing tanks had a zinc silicate coating. The pumpman and a sailor were running the machine cleaning, and the bosun was following behind with another sailor, starting ventilation fans as the washing finished, and then ejecting the remaining washing water from the after ends of the tanks. The first two tanks were tested by the chief officer, but he then went to attend to planning for the next cargo, leaving the subsequent testing in the hands of the bosun, who had received training in the use of testing equipment and was approved as an operator under the vessel's safety management system. Tank number 4, center port, was tested, and 21% oxygen was found. No evidence of toxic gas was noted. A green safe for entry tank was fitted to the lid, and the appropriate entry permit was filled out, although it was added to a folder of permits without the chief officer's verification signature being obtained at that time. The bosun entered the tank, climbing down the access ladder while the sailor lowered the suction hose from the ejector pump through a cleaning hatch above the sump. He did not wear any breathing apparatus or carry an emergency escape breathing device with him. At the time, the sea was calm, and the vessel had a considerable stern trim and a slight list, so quite a lot of water was lying in the outboard after corner of the tank. The bosun commenced removing this water, holding the suction pipe at a slight angle to maintain the suction. After approximately 2 minutes, and with around half of the water removed, he got a sudden blast of cargo vapour full in the face. He immediately dropped the ejector hose and ran towards the ladder. Catching his breath and with eyes watering, he climbed out of the tank, more by feeling his way from rung to rung than anything else. The sailor on deck had seen the bosun running away and already raised the alarm through his radio to the bridge. The chief officer had also heard the broadcast and was already halfway up the deck as the bosun emerged through the hatch. The bosun vomited over the side and then sat down, gradually recovering over the next 15 minutes or so. The chief officer tested the atmosphere in the tank for the record, but the ventilation fan had already stirred up the vapour to a noticeable level anyway. It was found that the cargo residue, being of a greater density, had settled beneath a layer of water in the corner of the tank. As the water was removed by the ejector, the product was exposed and the vapours were released. The meter readings obtained before entry were correct, because the cargo residue was effectively contained by the water, and the air above had been successfully purified by the ventilation fan. The bosun was not aware of the risk of cargo remaining, and simply trusted the meter readings. He did react when the conditions changed, but was lucky to escape from the tank without serious injury.